Hi guys, welcome to Confab with Shiv. Today on our show we have a very special guest. Most of you might have guessed it looking at the mascot behind me, Snappy. Today we are going to talk to wildlife photographer and CEO of Toehold Travel and Photography, Jayanth Sharma.
Hi Jayanth, welcome to my show.
Thank you.
And good to find you here in Bangalore in between your busy schedule. And thanks for time for the interview.
My pleasure.
The Jayanth that I knew, or what a lot of people knew, probably 10 years back, it was an IT guy who was into UX or user experience. He moved into wildlife photography.
Right.
Now he is one of India's most sought after wildlife photography tour leader, and probably you can even call a business person when it comes to photography and travel.
Right.
So tell us about your journey from an IT guy to a wildlife photographer.
Right, so I started doing photography seriously about 12 years ago, and as you know, I was spending a lot of time and free time going out and making images of wild animals and, you know, landscapes and things like that. So somewhere when it started growing out of proportions for me, when, you know, I happened to get advice from my existing IT manager who told me I should probably try and do it full time rather than do it during weekends and take holidays and do it. Fortunately, that year I won an award and I got a lot of pictures published in magazines, including, I remember, one of the magazines published four of my images in four of their cover pages out of six in that year. So that seemed like the best year for me to start, and then I took a bold decision to quit my job and try to do freelance photography. And since I was pretty good in technique and the instructional part of photography, I started doing workshops, and very soon I realized it's a model which is working. There were a lot of people who were interested in learning photography. So I met a couple of my partners then with whom I envisioned this idea of Toehold. And I started a company called Toehold about 7 years ago. And you know where we are right now.
Cool. The Jayanth that we knew before when it comes to wildlife photography, Jayanth was associated with the name Wildlife Times,
right,
which was your personal blog or the gallery, what you can call it.
Right.
So we were used to expecting the blogs, the very beautifully written blogs and images from Jayanth.
Mm-hmm.
That moved on to become Toehold.
Right.
Rather, Wildlife Times didn't become Toehold, but you moved into Toehold.
Right.
So what was the decision-making thing for you to switch over from a personal blog to an organization like Toehold, which is into more of photography and travel services?
Right. First of all, Wildlife Times was my personal website. And when I formed this company, I had partners who were not a part of my website. So we had to find another name where it is not just about me, it was a company also. And the reason why we didn't use Wildlife Times or anything like that as a name was because my idea, though I am a wildlife photography enthusiast and I do a lot of wildlife trips, and we even now in the company do a lot of wildlife photo tours, we didn't want Toehold to be a wildlife photography tour company only. In spite of that, we do a lot of wildlife trips, but just to give ourselves an opportunity to do street photography, glamour photography, landscape photography, portrait photography workshops, studio workshops, and even for that matter, post-processing workshops, or be it any genre of photography which is interested or which has interest in the audience, is what we wanted to do, which is why we wanted a name which is not a wildlife or nature or, you know, wilderness or anything, but something which is what signifies what we do today, which is provide a support to people to climb this mountain of photography. That's why we are at Toehold.
Cool. So you mentioned a point that you didn't want Toehold to be something related to wildlife, or key aspect being wildlife tours and things like that. So one main vertical of Toehold is rentals.
Right.
And if I'm right, you have your operations in two cities in India.
Correct.
And if I'm right in the stats wise, you're one of the leading photography equipment rental provider in India.
Right.
So tell us about, like, what are the different challenges that you face when it comes to running a photography equipment rental? Because this was not something which was existing.
Right.
Okay. This was a very lesser known aspect of photography when it started about like 8 years back.
Correct.
So what are the challenges or the hurdles you had to face when starting a rental company?
Right. So one is, you know, basically as a photographer, right, we don't enjoy, you know, doing a business where you take care of somebody's camera equipment and their needs and things like that. So we had to figure out a team whose primary job is not go out and click pictures, but to help people to go out and click pictures by giving them the equipment, the advice and things like that. So forming a team was a challenge before, because you know, you need people who, right from the reception staff to the manager who handles the equipment bookings to the delivery boys who go and deliver it. So we had to look at making a thorough team then. And today we are in Bangalore itself, we have a team of 7 people who manage only the rentals.
Okay.
The overall team in Bangalore is about 18 people in Toehold, and we have a 4-member team in Pune. So we had to set up a dedicated delivery boy, dedicated reception staff, dedicated manager who understands the photographer's needs. At the same time, their heart is not in going out and making pictures themselves. What I have realized in a service providing industry is, if we like to go and click pictures ourselves, we will not be able to help somebody better. You know, our job is to help them, which is what a Toehold philosophy is. So, I mean, when it comes to a tour, and we all like to click pictures, but we need a team whose primary job is to assist people. So setting up the team was the biggest challenge. Then, since it was not a proven business model, we didn't know if people will want to rent equipment, because usually people get a great amount of pride in owning a camera.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we needed a lot of practicality in the industry, where people say, okay, why should I invest a 2 lakh rupees on a lens, which I use 3 days in a month?
Mm-hmm.
So we had to educate people in order to make that a style of their photography, not buying something and keeping it in the shelf for 25 days a month to use it for 5 days a month.
Mm-hmm.
And gradually we had to also trust people who are doing photography, because it's a very risky business where somebody can take an equipment and run away. We have had cases where people have done that. We have had a lot of other rental companies who still face problems because they might not do a proper verification process. So we had to set a lot of things with this industry where it was not a standard operating procedure. Like, we had to figure out, okay, now we're going to do a verification. Now we're going to send somebody to their house. We're going to evaluate if the person is genuine, if they're using a fake name, fake ID. So it involved a lot of, you know, verification services as a challenge. It involved training our staff who are not photographers to understand what an FX is, DX is, what a full frame is, what a telephoto lens is, and all these kind of things. At the same time, ensure that a Toehold quality is maintained and kind of understand their needs and serve them. So everything we did in the rentals department was a new thing for us.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have some company that we can, you know, hire somebody who has worked in that company who will come here and start doing things. So we had to train anybody and everybody who worked for this department. And we had our challenges in the initial years, and now we have a reasonable team which can, take care of equipment requirements.
So, but if you fast forward the thing to 2016 or 2017,
mm-hmm.
We see that market is sort of saturated with rental companies.
Right.
And people who are starting these rental companies feel that this is a quick way to make bucks and like make a lot of money by renting out equipments and address the need of the photographers.
Right.
So where do you see this heading, and what do you see as the future of rentals?
Yeah, I think considering Bangalore, I mean, somebody told me that we have 27 camera rental companies in Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
But what I see is lacking in most rental companies is their need for somebody to find an equipment need and then come here and find an equipment.
Mm-hmm.
And also, since this is a very unorganized sector, none of the companies have been properly scaled, and none of them, including Toehold, doesn't have a proper investor, and we don't have a bigger scale. Now, starting a rental company is easy, but scaling it up is the difficult part. And with great difficulty, we have been able to only manage 2 centers so far, because ours is a self-funded, bootstrapped company.
Mm-hmm.
And we are doing business in, though we are doing business in 3 cities, we have 2 offices,
okay.
One in Pune and one in Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
We serve a lot of Mumbai from the Pune office,
okay.
Because the equipment can sit in Pune, but we can deliver it to Bombay anytime.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel a lot of rental companies we have come across might be showing a lot of equipment on their website,
mm-hmm.
but they might not have a lot of them, because they are trying to gather the interest of people. If 10 people ask a 500 mm, we'll buy another 500 mm kind of a concept. But for us, the fortunate thing for us is, since we don't wait for customers to get this need from outside, we kind of generate this need from within, because we have the workshop division, we have the photo tour division, we conduct close to 80-90 photo tours a year.
Okay.
We kind of create our own need also. I mean, most of our customers who come on photo tours kind of rent equipment from us. Okay. So we don't have to wait for somebody to do a wedding to come and rent equipment from us. Though we have a lot of people who rent equipment from us are not photo tour participants. But we do manage a lot of business from within our own pool of business units.
Okay.
So that is what has increased sales for us in the rental solution.
Cool. So coming back to you. So the thing is, like, when you started doing photo tours, so you are someone who concentrated a lot on Indian national parks like Ranthambore, Bandhavgarh, or even something in the south like Kabini. Later on, there was a point in time wherein you shifted your attention to very niche areas like Kamchatka, Costa Rica, mm-hmm. or places like Russia, where we like, or even Kenya.
Svalbard.
I mean, you spend a lot of time in Kenya as well.
Right.
So what made you think that, okay, and you are one of the key guys now who was looking into international wildlife market, like
right.
red capture photo tours.
Sure.
So what made you switch that attention from Indian photo tours to more of like the global stuff?
Right. I mean, this is personally speaking, though as a Toehold, we have a lot of Indian destinations also.
Yes.
So it was a situation where, you know, I was doing it alone when I was doing it as Wildlife Times. Mm-hmm. But when it became a Toehold, I had to do a lot of these destinations myself. Mm-hmm. When I used to travel to the Bandhavgarh, Ranthambore, Corbett, or Kaziranga, or Bandipur, Kabini, and all these destinations.
Mm-hmm.
But then one person can be in one place at any time. So I had to figure out how do I scale the business. I had a couple of partners then who were also very good in photography and are even now very well-known photographers. So we had to build a team. So we started adding more people into the team where each one handles a territory. And I was fortunate to get a colleague of mine called Sachin Rai, who joined us in 2011.
Okay.
And who probably took a lot of my burden of going to destinations like the Tiger Tour, going to destination like Corbett, Ranthambore, Bandhavgarh, and all these places where he enabled me to relieve myself from these destinations where we needed to do these tours.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a colleague then called Kiri who would handle destinations like Kabini and, you know, Bandipur and things like that. And it helped me to relieve myself of these destinations.
Mm-hmm.
And as a proper growth chart, I wanted to add destinations which nobody has been to, which is where the Kamchatkas, the Svalbard, Pantanal, Costa Rica, and all these were born. And fortunately, we have had a good acceptance in people where they're willing to go to any faraway destination, trusting our ability to take them to. So that's why we now have a big pool of people who have done about 6-7 continents of destinations with us.
Okay.
And so thankfully, because I had a capable colleague who started handling a lot of my responsibility, it gave me some opportunity to explore other places. And that is what is the success of photo tours for us, I think.
So having seen both the Indian side and outside, what do you feel are the main differences, especially when it comes to logistics or even shooting and training people on the field?
Right.
What are the main differences that you see or the challenges?
One of the biggest challenges is your national park permits. So I don't know any other place in the world apart from maybe Rwanda where we do the gorilla expedition,
mm-hmm.
where you need to procure permits well in advance.
Mm-hmm.
Nowhere else in the world I need to give notice to the national park to go. Like, for example, I can decide to go to Africa tomorrow morning,
mm-hmm.
and there's no problem in getting a permit or anything. Maybe I'll not get the accommodation in the place where I need,
mm-hmm.
but there's hundreds of lodges where I can stay.
Mm-hmm.
In India, the problem is not the accommodation. You still have hundreds of lodges. But the problem is if you don't plan 4 months or 3 months in advance,
mm-hmm.
then you'll not get a national park permit for a place like Bandhavgarh or Ranthambore or even Corbett for that matter, where we have so many problems.
Mm-hmm.
And when I speak to photographers across the world, this is one of the problems they notice about India, and they prefer not to come here because of that, because they have to have a lot of planning in advance, and, you know, they have to plan their dates. And even if they have the plans, we have seen, you know, a permit opens at midnight,
okay.
and in 3 minutes, 20 permits are gone, because the whole country is aiming for that permit on, let's say, if you are coming on a special day like a Christmas day or an August 15th weekend or a December 31st weekend,
mm-hmm.
you don't have an opportunity to even breathe for 5 minutes. The moment the permit opens, it's gone. So that's the biggest pain point in India. We have to figure out how to grab permits. In fact, in my office, when we do a trip to Bandhavgarh or Ranthambore, we bother everybody in the team to be online at 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock to pick up permits when they open. In spite of that, we lose out on some dates when, you know, it's too busy.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the first thing. Secondly, I feel in a place like Bandipur or Kabini or Bandhavgarh, the amount of safari hours that we get is really not worth the amount of time we are spending in that place. Like, I use an entire calendar day to go to Bandhavgarh, or to, for that matter, Kabini, where I have practically, if you calculate the time you enter the forest to the time you get out, you get 2.5 hours in the morning and 2.5 hours in the evening. Compared to a place like Africa, where you are there for 12.5 hours at least sometimes, where you might not shoot anything in the middle of the day, but you will keep an eye on the animal, where you're with the animal. Here you come out at 9 o'clock and you go back at 4 o'clock. In the middle of the day, animal can move 100 kilometers. So you don't know where the animal is. Again, you have to spend the time tracking it. Whereas in Africa, you find the animal at 8 a.m. and my animal might not do anything till evening, but it's under the bush. You can rest there, have your lunch and be with the animal. And it, when it does its thing at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the evening, you don't waste your time looking for it. Mm-hmm. So there is more value for money and time when you go to these kind of places. Okay. Having said that, India is fantastic. It's great. It's just that some of the rules are not very friendly. And I can understand why. There's a lot of tourists, there's a lot of people and things like that. But what I enjoy in going to other places is no restrictions of time, no safari hours. You can, you know, be there for the whole day. And of course, I don't have to plan it well in advance, which is what makes a big difference. Also, some of the places where I go to, the Arctic, the Antarctic, Russia, and these kind of places, the kind of light which is there, being the poles, is much different to compare to the light in India, which is more tropical. So it's a lot of sun in India. In the Arctic, there is of course a lot of soft light. There is a backlight situation which is very easy to do. Africa is great with backlight. The reason why I like Africa is not because I see a lion or a cheetah or a leopard all the time, because I can use backlight. Somehow the topography in Indian forests restrict you from using backlight, except you are in Rajasthan or you are in Gujarat in Run of Kutch or something. But in Africa, you can play with light a lot more than you can do with India, especially because you have open vast expanses where the light can be captured in various ways. So overall, you know, there's a lot of interesting things when you go out of India. And of course, I don't believe in political boundaries of wildlife. I don't mind going to the neighboring country which we don't like. If there is a lovely animal or a bird there, I would love to travel there. For me, it's not about India. Though I'm a patriotic person by nature, I'm not patriotic when it comes to wildlife. I'll go any part of the world to see nature, and that's been the way I've been working.
So looking at this challenge, if there's one place that's like your personal favorite, what is that?
Oh, without any second thought, it's the Arctic. Where I like to go to photograph polar bears. What I like about that place is the light and of course the landscape, which is so different from anywhere else that I have been to. So I would love to go there many times, and recently I've started enjoying Iceland, which is a great time to go during summer and a great place to go during winter as well. In fact, I'll be there in 3 days from now. So Iceland is pretty much the sub-Arctic, because the Arctic Circle just goes above Iceland. You have a lot of Arctic species in Iceland, but I go there for landscape photography opportunities.
Jayanth is one person who goes by the mantra that get it right in the camera rather than fixing it in post.
Right.
And we still feel that he's sticking to that mantra even as of this day.
Right.
How challenging is it to...
I have realized it's very easy as long as you are okay sacrificing an opportunity. The problem occurs to people where you have an opportunity where the light is not good, but you can't let go of that opportunity. You know, you want to capture something and you want to present it to the world. So the only way to fix that is, you know, using post-processing or manipulation or stuff like that. So when you spend a lot of time in the wild, in nature, you don't have that urge to show things very often. So over time, I've realized I have not even been lifting my camera at some situations where I don't see a photo opportunity.
Okay.
Like for example, I was recently there in Bandipur, and you know, when you see a wild dog or a leopard and you don't see a photo opportunity, there's no need to click a picture. So I have realized, I keep telling this to people in my workshop, in test cricket, when there's a great ball bowled outside your off stump, batsmen lift their bats and the commentator replies, "Wow, well left," right? That's what I do in my photography as well.
Okay.
I leave good balls which I can't handle well. So that's when I handle only balls which are bad, and I take them to the boundary.
Cool. So How much of an influence does technology and the cameras have on your photography then? Because you're someone who uses the latest and greatest cameras available in the market, and you're
right.
not too biased towards the brands as well.
Correct.
So how much of that has influenced your photography?
Oh, quite a lot. I embrace technology very fast. As you know, I shoot both Canon and Nikon. I like anything which is good in Canon. I'm happy to pick up anything which is good in Nikon. I feel technology has improved a lot of things in photography, and technology has also upgraded the benchmark of photography. You know, in earlier days, we would struggle to shoot. I remember my first picture, which was published on the cover page of Sanctuary, which was two monitor lizards fighting. I was on ISO 400 then, and during the days when Canon 30D, ISO 400 was a higher ISO.
Yeah.
Right? In that camera also, I got a lot of noise in 400 ISO. Today, I was in Costa Rica in the month of May or June, and I was using 5000 ISO to capture a bird called fiery-throated hummingbird.
Mm-hmm.
Even in 5000 ISO on a D5, I can't see grains.
Mm-hmm.
So technology has helped you to, you know, achieve greater things. It's given you a lot more tools, and you can work in lower lights now.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier, you had to only enjoy something through the naked eye. Now you can push your camera to perform even in low lights. So I've always been happy to embrace technology. The 2.8 lenses, the lighter lenses, the VR and the FL lenses, which are, you know, pretty good and sharp, and they do their job very well. Cameras can track very well now. Focusing algorithms are much better, which has helped in making images much better overall. So I'll be very happy if technology keeps on helping us to achieve. That's how you make images which were unimaginable 10 years ago.
Yeah, right. Sometime back, we even saw you use medium format cameras like S2 format.
Right.
So what was your thought behind being exploring medium format, and do we expect more landscape stuff from Jayanth apart from the wildlife?
Right. You know, I have been doing pretty much mammals and birds a lot compared to landscapes. About a couple of years ago when I went to US, I wanted to try a lot of my time with the Grand Canyon area, the Grand Circle as they call it. I spent time in Bryce Canyon, Antelope Canyon, all these places.
Mm-hmm.
So I used a Leica medium format, a Leica S camera then.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to, you know, compare the dynamic range of the cameras compared to a 35mm camera and a medium format camera. Though I had a great experience using it, I must tell you that to a large extent, I was disappointed by the ISO performance of these cameras.
Mm-hmm.
They're pretty bad. But what I was happy with was the dynamic range. But if you look at a camera like a Nikon D5 or a D810, where the dynamic range is close to 13 stops of light,
mm-hmm.
Today the advantage of a medium format is probably not as much as it used to be before, is what my learning from my own experience was. So I'm not too sure if I'll spend too much money and time using medium format cameras,
mm-hmm.
Because you know, they are not really as useful to me in low light.
Okay.
In great light, they are pretty good. So I shoot a lot in low light, in rainforests, in, you know, areas where the light is very low. So I'm kind of not too sure if I'll keep on using medium format. But I enjoyed a lot using the Leica S and some great lenses along with it.
So you mentioned about rainforest, you told about a lot of Indian forests. You're one person who has explored underwater photography as well, diving in underwater. So where do you see that going, like do you plan to explore much on that field?
Absolutely. In fact, I'm very guilty about not being able to do much with underwater photography for the last 1 year. That's because I have assumed a new role in my business, and I've been very busy managing the business apart from my must-do obligations. But I do hope that I'll make some time to, you know, explore underwater photography in detail. I have shortlisted some destinations where I want to work seriously,
mm-hmm.
and make some images in the long run. For example, I'm very interested in going back to Raja Ampat in the tropical waters there, and in the, closer to the Papua area. I want to go to Fiji and all these places. Galapagos is one of my dream destinations when it comes to both terrestrial and underwater.
Mm-hmm.
So I do hope to get back to diving soon. It's been a few months now. In fact, I don't even have an underwater camera as we speak. I've just gotten rid of my older camera because I was not using it as much. But 2017 might probably be a busy year again, because I have a lot of trips that I have planned and a lot of destinations that I want to cover and explore and bring to the table. But diving is something that I can't stop. I have to continue doing it. In the second quarter of 2017,
mm-hmm.
I plan to make some time for diving and explore there. Having said that, when I realized that I don't have as much time to dive and, you know, show people what I can, I have recently got my dive master and my friend Umid Mistry, mm-hmm. on board of Toehold. He is now conducting underwater workshops for Toehold, and we hope to see a growing interest in that in the near future.
So, so many different genres within wildlife photography itself, right? Shooting on land, shooting underwater, and even you have explored things like wide angle wildlife photography.
Correct, correct.
How much of it is needed? Like, how do you need to catch up with such new stuff to stay ahead in the competition?
Right. I mean, it's pretty interesting. Every few years, there's something which becomes a trend. Like, you know, I think 3 years, 2 years ago, after we saw these stunning pictures of a very famous photographer, people were crazy about using camera trap with DSLR technology, and they've done reasonably good work. I still like to do a lot of wide angle animal portraiture and, you know, get close to the animal and shoot the landscape with the animal. Now you're using a lot of drones to capture animals from a different perspective. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, the trends keep changing, mm-hmm. and every few years they go back to what it was 10 years ago or 5 years ago. So it's interesting. Right now, I think it's very boring to see a telephoto lens used to capture a portrait of an animal where you have a complete out of focus background and a sharp subject. That I think is a gone trend now. You know, people now have realized wildlife photography is not about an animal only, it's also about a landscape. So a wildlife image with a habitat kind of perspective is what is more interesting to people.
Mm-hmm.
Having said that, there are some interests in abstract nature photography also, which is growing, which makes a lot of interest to some people. So, I mean, going with the trend is very interesting. There are also people who are species-oriented photographers who like to document wildlife,
mm-hmm.
whereas there are some who like to make creative images or pretty pictures, as they call it. I probably fall under the pretty picture making category, and even though I like to shoot different species, I'm not more of a documentation photographer that I go to this place to document this animal or that, but I like to make creative images.
Mm-hmm.
So keeping up with the trend is very important to be one of the best, which is where you'll realize that you have to learn from many photographers abroad. But thankfully for me, I partnered with the best in the industry from various countries, like in Costa Rica and Svalbard and Pantanal, and I learn faster than I can learn here because there is the whole world to benchmark against.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So when we look at your portfolio, wildlife portfolio, you have like sort of like you're not touched upon a point which you feel that it's important or stuff like that. But you're someone who stays away from competitions and contests and things like that.
Right.
Any specific reason behind
that? Not really any specific reason. In fact, when I was pushed recently, I submitted an image to the Nature's Best contest and was fortunate to be the honorable mention of an image of a rainbow in the background of a giraffe.
Mm.
I forgot to submit my images on time for the recent BBC thing.
Mm.
It's just that is not what drives me to do photography. You know, whenever I have the time and I see there is a contest and I have an interest to submit, I don't have a. I'm not like Amir Khan who says no to awards and award functions. I would love to get an award if it's a prestigious contest.
Okay.
But at the same time, I don't make photos only for awards.
Okay.
So if at all things fall in place and I have the mood and the time and the thing, I go ahead and submit it.
Okay.
So far, I've participated in 3-4 contest. In fact, I must mention that a wildlife photography contest is one of the reasons why I became a professional. I'm very grateful to Sanctuary for recognizing my talent as a wildlife photographer. But there are people who go out and shoot images in order to compete.
Mm-hmm.
I'm probably not one of them. So I don't make images only for competitions, but I don't have an aversion to contests. I'll be happy to participate if I remember it.
Okay. Switching gears a little bit, going back in time. So, not many people know Jayanth is also a trained classical singer, and at least I have not seen much of his singing aspect since last few years.
Right.
Tell us about your other likes.
Yeah. So, I mean, as a kid, I was always interested in extracurriculum. I was never a ranked student material.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even get jealous of my classmates who would get 90, 95, 93. I would be happy to in my late 70s or early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
So, I would be looking at spending my time in school and college doing things which makes me more excited. Music was one of the most important things for me then. Dramatics was one more. Painting was one more. Outdoors was quite a lot of interesting things for me. So, I learned Carnatic classical music as a child, and as a teenager I also performed in All India Radio and even Doordarshan and things like that. So I was pretty serious at one point. probably I ended up in the IT industry where a lot of things changed, and I came to Bangalore from Mysore, and the whole cultural strength that I had in Mysore was not there with me in Bangalore as a bachelor here when I came. But I lost touch then. But I do try and keep myself interested in music. I sing once in a while. I do use tracks and record stuff at home, and you know, for friends and family I do. However, my brother is still very active with music. He performs on stage in many shows even now.
You've been like one person who is like very busy traveling across the globe.
Right.
So how do you balance your work life and personal life? How are things at home when it comes to your traveling? Because most part of the year you're outside India.
Correct.
So
right.
How do you?
I must really thank my family to allow me to get out of home so often. Especially my wife. She allows me to exercise my interest as much as I can, and she was so cooperative that she came and also handled my business. She handles the rentals business here and is managing that department. So it's not difficult as long as the family is supportive. I probably travel 15 days a month on average. There are some months I don't travel, or some months I travel a month completely, like February, March, and completely out. Mm-hmm. In most of the months I travel a few days at least. Right now is the prime of my life. I have to put a lot of efforts and see the best I can, and I have a dream to see as many places I can before I die. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to keep it for my retirement, so I want to do it now. And once I feel there are a lot of places I've seen, I might slow down. Mm-hmm. And otherwise I'm happy to go, every few days I'm traveling, and I like to also see places that are unique. Mm-hmm. and what some people around here have not been able to do. So that's what inspires me to go and travel again and again.
So for the people who are looking at from the other side of things, they see like, okay, Jayanth is always traveling, he's going to exotic places and shooting some never before seen animals and things. But what is your side of story, especially things related to your travel, your stress, your health related?
If you can see, I'm not very healthy to look at. I'm a little on the plus side. The problem is I can't stick to a regime of fitness, and I can't do things there. It takes a toll. Travel takes a toll because you're always in the flights, you're traveling to different destinations, you are adjusting to time zones, you have jet lag issues when you come back, and you have a lot of responsibilities back in office which is related to the same business but still not clicking pictures. Right now me being the CEO of the company, I have to look at financials, I have to look at the statutory compliances, I have to look at hiring, I have to look at many such things. So it does take a toll on business. There's a lot of mental stress also that you go through because you are remote in some place in a remote destination, and you get calls about some issue that has come up here, and you have to give attention to this place, and you feel so bad that you're not able to do something sitting there. Mm-hmm. And you have an urgent need to perform something in office or in Bangalore or something. So it's a lot stressful when you're out of to be honest, I must tell you very honestly, when I'm traveling I am as stressed as I am, because I have my heart here where I have to run the show. At the same time, I have my heart there where I have to enjoy the place and deliver it to my clients when I'm there. So it's very difficult to maintain a balance. I have a plan to reduce the number of days I'm traveling over time, but as of now, it's not the time to think about it.
Okay. So talking about what do you want to do in future, like what's ahead, like what's ahead in 2017 or in future, both for you to explore places as well as Toehold?
I feel I have about 10 years of great photography for myself, because I don't think I can compete with the younger generation after that. So these 10 years is where I am planning to build the company in the best possible way. As individually as a photographer, I plan to explore more destinations which are never done before. Right? This year I am setting up a destination called Patagonia. We are bringing a mountain lion photo tour on the table, which has never been done by anybody in India so far. So like that, I will still push myself to do something which is not done before. As a company, we have been growing leaps and bounds, and now we are in a stage where we have to scale our business. So we have been always busy doing stuff, and to be honest, we are kind of a benchmark, I am believing, in the industry right now. And we have a lot of responsibility to, show that this is a business to stay and grow. Mm-hmm. So I hope to scale the business by whatever extent it can, which means we might probably talk to prospective funding agencies or VCs or angel investors and look at growing the business. I personally feel we are still 10% of what we can be. Okay. So we have a long way to go.
Okay. any plans to expand to other cities like the metro or something?
Yeah, we do have plans, but since we are a self-funded company, it's not going to happen till we, you know, figure out an investment model.
Okay.
So we definitely are looking out for opportunities, which is why we went to Pune.
Mm-hmm.
We probably will start serving Bombay in the near future.
To wind up the show, I would like to ask one main question, or like, what's your suggestion for youngsters and upcoming wildlife photographers that they should keep their thought on when they're making this?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, Shiva, you know me since about close to 12, 13 years now. We all started doing wildlife photography not because we wanted to become professionals in it.
Mm-hmm.
We started doing wildlife photography because we enjoyed nature, we enjoyed the wilderness, we enjoyed the process of going there and enjoying it and making the photos. Now I see people coming to workshops asking me how they can quit their job and become, you know, I feel youngsters are putting themselves in a situation where they are pressurizing themselves,
mm-hmm.
thinking when they click pictures, they have to click it as a professional. I feel you can enjoy it a lot more if you treat that as an endeavor which makes you happy, or as a hobby, or as a field which gives you the you know, exposure to express your passion. But I think many people want to become professionals in this field, which is where they go through a lot of stress. I've seen this happen to ex-colleagues of mine who have tried to become professional photographers in the shortcut or in a faster way. I mean, there are some of us who are lucky and who were fortunate to do this, but it doesn't mean you know, that is the only thing to do. I feel people shouldn't start doing photography thinking they want to be a professional. They should start doing photography and learn photography to enjoy themselves. The moment it becomes a profession, then you can't shoot what you want, when you want, where you want. So it'll become a project, it'll also have its deadline, it'll also have a client, you'll also have some economics which will drive the business. So my suggestion to people is, please don't ask this question of, you know, how do I become a professional wildlife photographer? It seems to me as a very weak question to ask, because you need to understand there is no such career opportunity in India. It is very easy to fall for it and say, okay, I'll also become one. But I would say, become a good photographer. If you ask me, how do I become a good photographer? The answers are plenty.
Mm-hmm.
If you ask me, how do I become a wildlife photographer? The answer is none, right? So I would suggest people to first learn to become a good photographer.
Mm-hmm.
Then if, you know, if there is something in them and, you know, it's destiny that makes them be that, it will happen. But otherwise, don't pressurize yourself and want to become it from the day one. I think many people are really losing it, wanting to become a professional photographer.
Mm-hmm.
And they are not doing well in their existing careers, they have relationship problems, at the same time, they are not able to achieve something in photography. So, please treat photography as an endeavor which makes you happy and lively. Don't treat that as a profession.
Cool. Thanks a lot for those words, and keep inspiring us with your work and take us to new places where people have not been in our part of the country. And thanks a lot for your time for this talk show, and good luck for all your future.
Thank you, Shiva. Thanks a lot.
So that was Confab with Shiv, featuring Jayanth Sharma, photography mentor and CEO of Toehold Travel and Photography. If you liked what you just saw, make sure that you hit the thumbs up button. And if you have any photographers in mind who you want to see on this program, make sure that you write their names in the comment section below, and I'll try to reach out to them in the future episodes. Also, please make sure that you subscribe to the channel for regular updates. Thank you for watching. See you in the next one.